So this week we have Paolo Bianchini, Paolo did his graduate work at the Max Planck Institute in Heidelberg, working with Ben Ben, and is now a CEBA National Fellow and Master collaborating a lot with Allison Silt. Paolo's done a lot of work on elucidating how Gabi clusters work, and showed that they're not as simple as perhaps previously thought, and I think he'll tell us a bit more about that today.
Thank you. So it's very good to be here. A lot of interesting talks this morning with people, and it's somehow being back at CETA is like going back to your parents when you're at school and to tell them how you spend the money that they gave you. It's like, yeah, I'm trying to do a good job and tell you what I've been doing the last 5 months. So I'm going to focus particularly on some work projects, some ongoing projects that I've been doing ever since moving at McMaster University, and of course giving you a broader perspective of why should we care about globular clusters at all, and in particular focusing on the kinematics of globular clusters. It has been one of my greatest interests so far. So this is a very easy scheme that should represent what is the goal of doing some globular cluster science. These are globular clusters today. What we want to know eventually is trying to understand how this system formed 13 giga years ago. It's pretty tricky because suppose that all you have is the information that you see today. So suppose that all the information that you know about me is the way I look today, and you want to understand how, where I went to school, in what was my address when I was 3 years old. It's probably a very challenging research that you have to do. And indeed, all my research focuses on understanding of getting a lot of information about the globular cluster structure right now. Give you an introduction about globular cluster, particularly the galactic globular cluster. This is how I define a globular cluster to my mom. These are very typical Italian cookie, and it's exactly what we thought the globular cluster was, at least what I was taught back at university. Globular cluster is a spherical, simple stellar system formed with stars only, is isotropic, is not rotating, and all the stars are homogeneous in their chemical composition. Now we know that this is not right, it's completely the wrong picture, plus we have no idea of how globular cluster formed 13 giga years ago. So my goal of today is trying to understand you why this simplistic picture of a globular cluster is not valid anymore. And I want to also show you how can we use the complexity to understand the formation of the globular cluster. To do so, we have to do a step backwards and trying to look the global characteristics of a globular cluster. This is a plot that I like to call the zoo of globular clusters of small stellar system. We have the size of stellar system on the y-axis and the magnitude and the brightness of the stellar system on the x-axis, and you see globular cluster, our stellar system right here, they're not too bright. They have a typical radius of about few parsecs, and they seem very distinct from other stellar systems that are, for example, the dwarf galaxies. They are one or two order of magnitude in size bigger. We know they're different because the dwarf galaxies are dark matter dominated system, while globular cluster are purely stellar. Stellar system. So from this picture, one could just be happy and say dwarf galaxy and globular cluster are very well different. And in fact, if you go and look at their stellar population, you see a typical globular cluster here on the right, simple stellar population represented by a very nice isochrone in the color magnitude diagram, while if you take a dwarf galaxy, you see that the stellar population is way more complex, and you have indeed a very complex color magnitude diagram that basically is pointing to the fact that you have multiple episodes of star formations due to the fact that the dwarf galaxy was in a in the potential well, basically, of dark matter and was able to retain enriched material. But if you look closely, we have this and look into, for example, the metallicity of globular cluster on the x-axis and the spread in metallicity of the stellar system on the y-axis, you see again the globular cluster generally tend to be given a metallicity to have a lower spread in metallicity, so they're single metallicity stellar system, while dwarf galaxy have a larger spectrum of metallicity, but there are some interesting systems which are globular cluster in the Milky Way, in particular M54 and Omega Centauri, that show actually some chemical characteristic very similar to dwarf galaxies. Those two globular clusters, Omega Centauri and M54, are in fact the two most massive stellar systems in the Milky Way, globular clusters in the Milky Way, and are suspected for several reasons to be accreted stellar system. So they're suspected not to be formed as standard globular cluster, but to be something a little bit more weird. So if you take that into consideration, and for example, look at Omega Centauri, and you look closely into the color magnitude diagram, you see that the simple stellar population hypothesis is not valid anymore. You do see different population characterized by different turn-off here in the color magnitude diagram. But also, if you look into the dynamics, you see some more complex dynamical things happening. And plus, people have been claiming the existence of an intermediate mass black holes in the center. So this brought to the suspect that some globular cluster maybe were originated at nuclei of dwarf galaxies that later got accreted into the Milky Way. But if you look at normal globular cluster, they're not easy as well. This that you see here is the giant branch of a globular cluster, 1851, a fairly standard globular cluster. But if you look in particular band with HST, particularly going close to the ultraviolet, you will see that the single stellar population is not valid anymore, and you have double up sequences. And those sequences do not differ in metallicity, but differ only in light element abundances. So given a metallicity, every globular cluster is able to create a different stellar population that goes under the name of multiple stellar population. And those multiple stellar population, given a metallicity, are different only in light elements, so sodium, oxygen, for example. So I'm not going to talk today about multiple stellar population. Is an ongoing topic, and people do not know how to form those populations at the very few tens mega years of a globular cluster formation, globular cluster life. But if you go back into the zoo picture and we try to put back some stellar systems, the size of the stellar system is now on the x-axis and the brightness is on the y-axis. The globular cluster are down here. You see that the nuclear star clusters are up here, and those globular clusters that are suspected to be nuclei are in the area overlapping between the nuclear star cluster and the globular cluster. And this system branching down are the dwarf galaxies. And if you look at the faint dwarf galaxies, or how people like to call them, ultra-faint dwarf galaxies, there are some systems that are genuine globular clusters. They are right in between globular cluster and dwarf galaxies. So if you take this picture together and take all the things that are overlapping with each other, it's becoming a little bit messy to understand what is actually a galaxy and what is actually a cluster. That's why people have continually pushing to the idea that some globular clusters are actually former galaxies, and the idea is the idea of the accretion origin of some globular cluster. This is an image of the Pandas team done with Pan-STAR survey of Andromeda galaxy, and you can see there are many stellar streams that are basically representative of accretion processes that have happened throughout the history of the galaxy. You see, for example, very nice tattletales of a dwarf galaxy falling in. And every time you have a galaxy falling inside another galaxy, that galaxy will bring in the globular cluster system that they have. And it's particularly interesting that in external galaxies, for example, the galaxies NGC 3628, that this is a stellar stream of in this galaxy. And if you look closely in the center of the stream, you see an object that looks like that Omega Centauri in our Milky Way. So it seems that we are able to see this stripping process of globular clusters that are actually nuclei of dwarf coming inside our other galaxies. And indeed, in the Milky Way, one of probably the most robust plot that would support the idea of some accreted globular cluster is the metallicity and age relationship of Milky Way globular clusters, in which two distinct categories of globular clusters can be distinguished. Some globular cluster at a given age with higher metallicity are globular clusters are suspected to have formed in situ in the Milky Way during the early phase of the galaxy formation, while other globular clusters were suspected to have fallen inside the Milky Way during the different accretion processes. So one of the goals is to clearly understand which globular cluster has been accreted and which globular cluster has instead formed in situ. And we have to do that in a very robust way. And the only thing that we have, as I told you earlier, is the properties of the globular cluster today. And the properties of the globular cluster today are very different of the properties of the globular clusters at formation because they went through 13 gigayears of dynamical evolution. 13 gigayears of dynamical internal evolution, so due to driven by two-body relaxation, stellar evolution, of course, we have stars that evolve, plus we have globular clusters that interact with the external galaxies, their host galaxies. So we have to put together all these internal and external processes, make them run for 13 gigayears, and see what we end up with. And the strategy that I like the most is try to use all the information that we have about the internal kinematics right now. The reason why using the kinematics, so the movement of stars, is that the kinematics provide a long-lasting fossil records of what has happened in the globular cluster. Plus, we are now living in the era where there's a gigantic amount of kinematic data for Milky Way globular clusters. And to give you an idea, we saw already the typical color magnitude diagram of a globular cluster. The kinematic information that we used to have until 5 years ago was just the traditional line of sight velocities of some stars, around 100 or a few hundred stars for a given globular clusters, only of the bright stars. Only of the bright stars, simply because spectroscopy is very time expensive. So you go on bright stars, it takes less to measure the velocity of the star. What we have right now is something incredibly better because we're able to sample the kinematics of many stars of the globular cluster down along the main sequence using HST proper motions. So why HST proper motions are cool? Well, first of all, proper motion gives you a two-dimensional velocity information. So you do not only have the line of sight, you have the two-dimensional vector on the plane of the sky. Plus, we are able to sample up to 100,000 stars per a given globular clusters. So a factor of two or more of what we were used to do earlier. And then we are able to sample stars that are less bright. Stars that are less bright in a stellar system like a globular clusters are also stars that are less massive. So for the first time, you're able to sample the kinematics for stars that are massive and stars that are not massive. And soon, we're going to do even better. So we're going to be ready for these things coming up with the Gaia data coming up in the next years or couple of years that will give us line of sight velocity for the bright stars, especially in the outer part of globular clusters, and again, unprecedented amount of proper motions. With all of this together, there's no excuses anymore of not using kinematic information. Just to give you an example of the HST proper motion, that is something that I've been working on during my PhD as well. This is a globular cluster, M15, 7078. This is the color magnitude diagram of the globular cluster, the main sequence. Every dot here is a measured 2D velocity information. And if you calculate, if you measure the velocity dispersion of the globular cluster, something already interesting comes up, which is stars that are more bright, so stars that are more massive, have a lower velocity dispersion than stars that are less massive. I'm going to talk about this more in details because this is actually carrying a lot of interesting information about the evolution of globular clusters. And in particular, having all of this as a background, all these kinematic observations as a motivation, what I would like to show you today is three points, in particular connected to some modeling effort on my side, in which we can better understand some kinematic ingredients and how can we link these kinematic ingredients to the formation. For example, the fact that globular clusters rotate, the fact that globular clusters are affected by the phenomenon of energy equipartition, and then finally, the fact that the velocity distribution is actually anisotropic, and what can we learn from the fact that the velocity distribution right now is anisotropic. So I will start from the first. Globular cluster rotate. We've been knowing that only since people have been starting measuring velocity of globular clusters, or just measuring spectra and trying to look for rotation. Why is that being a challenging topic? Because the typical rotation is very low. It's about 1 or 2 kilometers per second. So remember, a globular cluster has a velocity dispersion of about 5 kilometers per second. So if you measure a typical V over sigma, so order motion divided by random motion, you have a very low number, 0.2 usually. That means the globular cluster are still fairly a pressure supported system, this dispersion supported system. So rotation is small, but it's still there. That's why it's important to understand what is the role of rotation. Then, if some globular cluster were former nuclei of dwarf galaxies, we do know the nuclei of like nuclear star cluster. We do know the nuclei of galaxies rotate a lot. So if we think that Omega Centauri, for example, is a accreted nuclei, we should indeed expect rotation. What can we learn from the similarities of nuclear star cluster? And finally, the final goal is to try to characterize the three-dimensional rotation structure, which is the way basically to understand what's happening. The way to do that, and the way I've been doing that, was using distribution function-based models to model all the information that we have on the photometry and on the kinematics. The idea is that you have the Boltzmann collisionless equation, with f is your distribution function. You set up your distribution function, making sure that you get all the ingredients that you want. In particular, what we want is to have a quasi-relaxed model and to put inside some differential rotation. And that's been work done at the University of Milan with Annalisa Vare. And the first application of the model was made by me on a sample of globular cluster. As you can see, a rotating model is able to describe not only the photometry that I'm not showing here, but the velocity dispersion of a globular cluster and the rotation profile of a globular cluster. So as you can see, the rotation peak is about 1 kilometer per second. So we're really talking about a very challenging observation as well. But it's pretty impressive that we're able to, with a distribution function-based model, to describe the global dynamics of the cluster. And this is for a cluster in particular. This is for another cluster, 47 TAC. That again, we applied the rotating model to the data that we had back then. And back then, we had no information about the proper motions. We only had information along the line of sight. And that's where my recent work comes into place, is can we learn something from the proper motion? I was telling you that we have a lot of proper motion data thanks to the HST proper motion team based in STSCI. What can we learn? So is the picture that we had back in the day still correct? And to give you an idea of what we're talking about 47 TAC. If you have been looking to this picture for long enough, you are able to recognize the rotation axis, which is this direction, and the cluster is flattened in this direction. I don't know if maybe I've been looking way too much, but the model says that. So, yeah. And the cool thing about this cluster is that by chance, the small Magellanic cloud is in the background. Why is that the cool thing? Well, HST proper motion, even though they're cool, they have an intrinsic problem. They are only relative. Since the globular cluster in the center, that's where HST is looking at, is very crowded, it's very hard to have an absolute reference frame. So you cannot put a reference frame of distant galaxy. You don't see distant galaxies. But if you have other stars in the background, for example, the background star of the Magellanic Cloud, then you can basically pinpoint your proper motion to the stars of the Magellanic Cloud, and what you see is that the Magellanic Cloud is basically rotating the opposite direction of your rotation of the cluster. So the HST proper motion take away the rotation of the cluster, but this rotation that you've taken away is reflected in the stars of the Magellanic Clouds. And that's what we've been doing on the data side, and the data effort has been led by Andrea Bellini in Baltimore. And the idea is that if this is the color magnitude diagram, so there's different fields, an inner field, a central field, an outer field of the globular cluster, just pick your favorite. The black one are the star of 47 TAC. The red one are the background stars of the Magellanic Cloud. You have the measurement of the velocity for each of these stars. So that gives you the plots up here that is the velocity space. As you see, the globular cluster stars are centered in 0, 0 because the rotation has been subtracted. But the rotation of the Magellanic Cloud is of the cluster, sorry, is reflected in a Magellanic Cloud. So we've been using the reflected rotation in the Magellanic Cloud to estimate the rotation of the globular cluster on the plane of the sky. And what we get is a picture like this. This is the center of the globular cluster. And this basically each field, we have average over each field. And what you see is that the globular cluster is indeed rotating. So thanks to this very big effort in the data side, we have now rotation on the plane of the sky. So we can complement our information on the line of sight with a rotation profile on the plane of the sky. And so this is the rotation profile on the plane of the sky. And the first thing that you see is that this line here is what the best fit model that we used back in 2013 was predicting. And the first thing that appears is that the rotation on the plane of the sky is way higher than what we expected. We're talking about values of about 6 km/s. So the globular cluster is rotating more on the plane of the sky than on the line of sight. This is basically telling us that the inclination angle of the globular cluster is pretty inclined toward the line of sight. So we rerun the model with now different inclination angles, and we found the new best fit model that is able to describe photometry, flattening of the globular cluster, and this velocity dispersions, both in the proper motion and in the line of sight, so a three-dimensional velocity dispersion, and the velocity profile, rotation profile in the line of sight, and again, in the same time, the proper motion along on the plane of the sky, the rotation on the plane of the sky. And what it comes out is that we have, for the first time, an estimate of what is the rotation structure of the globular cluster. So we know what's the inclination angle of the rotation axis. And this gives us the possibility of measuring the intrinsic amount of rotation that we have in the globular cluster. And if you go and measure and basically go at the predicted V over sigma, as I told you earlier, people have been thinking that the typical V over sigma for a globular cluster is 0.1, 0.2, so very small. Well, this globular cluster has a peak of V over sigma of about 0.9. So globular cluster, at least this one that we've seen, is rotating a lot. And why do we know that? Well, we know that because we've been looking at the proper motion that gave us the extra two-dimensional information that we had not before. So what do we learn? Why are we excited about rotation? Well, first of all, we have an idea of how our stellar system is now rotating. So we have a 3D intuition of the rotation structure. And now, if we know that the globular cluster is rotating right now, this is putting strong constraints on how must have been rotating back at formation. So what you need to form a globular cluster like this is basically already a primordial globular cluster that was rotating quite a lot, because then you need to dissipate the angular momentum and finally get to the final picture that we have right now. Yes?
Can I go back to that slide? So you want to simultaneously fitting for this velocity dispersion as well?
Yeah. I don't have the plot here, but basically it's a chi-square fitting, nothing sophisticated, where we fit all the kinematics information. So there's the three dispersion profiles, the two rotation profiles, and the surface brightness profile.
So now doesn't this change in rotational velocity means the mass has to go up or something? Because
so what is changing actually is the inclination angle.
Sure.
So we were thinking that the inclination, we had like an assumption in the modeling before that the so basically the dashed line, that the inclination angle was 45 degrees. We have no idea what it was. Now what we realize that it is actually more inclined this way. So basically what's happened is that even if the rotation was probably comparable, right, what you basically see with this projection is that you see a stronger rotation.
The sigma you already
knew before. The sigma we knew before, yes.
Right. And now what you find is that there's a higher rotational support.
Yeah.
So this doesn't mean at the same radius. It doesn't mean the mass has to go up?
No. So the mass is actually, the mass estimate that we get from this new best fit model is comparable to the mass that we got earlier. So it's I don't know how to explain it.
We find a new support against gravity, this rotation.
Yeah, but also before we had no idea what how the velocity dispersion looked in the proper motions, right? So what we've been adding now in the modeling is not only this plot here, but other two velocity dispersion plots.
How significant can you measure those? Because Your velocities are really average over many things. So even in the proper motions, you actually measure their velocity dispersion.
Yeah, so we have velocity I do not have the plot here, but the velocity dispersion are pretty well measured. Yeah, they're very well measured. So it's the typical error in the proper motions in kilometer per second is around 1 kilometer per second or better. And this globular cluster is one with a velocity dispersion of about 10, 12 kilometer per second. So actually, it's easier to measure the velocity dispersion than to measure the rotation. Yeah, I'm happy to talk further later. So this will be like one message. Okay, it's rotating right now. Please, let's remember globular cluster rotate. Every time we want to make a globular cluster at formation, we have to make it sure that it rotates. Second point of my talk, which is labeled as number 3, just to spice it up a bit, energy equipartition. We have, again, the cookie that my mom likes. And globular clusters are complex, as I was saying, and one of the complexities is that we have stars that are more massive, the blue stars here, and stars that are less massive, the red star there. What happens is that globular clusters are also, they have experienced a lot of relaxation time, a lot of two-body interactions, and two-body interaction makes, what it does is basically makes the star exchange energy within each other. So you will have the high-mass stars that will lose energy and give away their energy to the low-mass stars. While the high-mass stars lose energy, they sink in the center and they lose kinetic energy, while the low-mass stars gain energy and move outward. This is the phenomenon of energy equipartition that causes mass segregation, so massive stars to move in the center while they lose kinetic energy. And if energy equipartition is reached fully, then you expect that a certain star with a certain mass to have a velocity dispersion, so m sigma square of a certain type of stars should be equal to the m sigma square of another type of stars. To give you a relation of the type, the velocity dispersion should be proportional to the mass to the minus 1/2. This, although, is not reached, and we do know it from earlier analytical and simulation work, and we know that only partial equipartition is reached. That means the stars do exchange energy in a globular cluster, but not in such a way to reach this exponent of 0.5. So the relation will hold, but will not be that steep. Why is this interesting? Well, it's very interesting because it's telling us that the velocity dispersion that we're measuring depends on the mass. It doesn't matter if it's full equipartition or if it's only partial equipartition. We are measuring a dispersion that is mass-dependent. And the mass-dependent kinematics has been neglected because we didn't have this data. Now that we have this data, you do see that the mass dependence of the kinematics is measurable, is there. So what can we learn from it? Can we just exploit it at best? And we see it only in line of sight, in very state-of-the-art data with a VLT, with the MUSE spectrograph. People are also starting to be able to basically measure for the bright stars, for the line of sight, the different kinematics. And this, systematically, we're seeing these different kinematics for stars with different masses. So what's their goal? The goal is, okay, can we trying to understand how this mass dependence of the kinematics, sigma n, works. Can we describe it? Can we find a good way to describe it for our simulations? And can we find also a good way to describe it for observation, so that we have a direct link in between observation and simulations? And can this mass dependence of kinematics tell us something about the state of partial equipartition that we reach? So can we say a cluster is very close to full equipartition, or a cluster is not close at all to equipartition? So that would be goal number one. Goal number two is like, OK, after we understand how close to equipartition we are, can we relate this quantity to some of the properties of the globular cluster? And this is some of the work that I've done and some of the work that I'm doing still right now at McMaster, and it starts with simulations. It's a set of large simulations, of Monte Carlo simulations, of globular clusters with a large number of particles. So the key here is to have simulations with a realistic number of particles. We're talking about 500,000 to up to 2,000,000 particles with initial binary fraction, different concentrations, and we're going to follow up the cluster throughout the age. What we want to see is how the velocity dispersion changes with mass, so we're going to construct from these simulations a lot of these profiles and trying to easily find a fitting function. So we know that if full equipartition was happening, this would have been the fitting function. We know that this is not happening, so we need a fitting function for partial energy equipartition. And given basically the simulation that we have, we can put already two constraints. At very low mass, there's not of a big dependence, but at very high mass, we are reaching basically the asymptotic limit of full energy repartition. So we're looking for a function that does like way with possibly one single parameter that is telling us, which we call mass of equipartition, that is telling us how close we are to full equipartition. And after playing a bit with functions, going back to the old good exponential function, which is basically what this function is giving us a trend exactly like the trend that we're looking for. It's an exponential function with a single parameter, which is the mass of equipartition, and it's telling us that if the mass of equipartition is lower, so if this number is lower, then we have a curve that is like this, so it's closer to full energy equipartition. So we want to basically apply this fitting function to all our simulations, to all our snapshots. This is what all the data from the simulation look like. Given a radius, we calculate the velocity of dispersion for different mass bins. That's the relation that we obtain. That's the fit that we get. We get a parameter of equipartition of 2. This basically is telling us that if you had stars with mass higher than 2, those stars would be in full equipartition between themselves. But we don't have stars with mass higher than 2 in a globular cluster because they're all stellar system. The maximum mass is 0.9 solar masses for bright stars. Then we want to use this also for observation, so we tested it also for observational-like data. And what observation will give us is measurement in the range of mass in between 0.4 to 0.7 with proper motions, and then 0.8, this desired end part with line of sight velocities. And what we do is do a discrete fitting, so no binning. We use all the information that we have. And the fit that we do only using this data here, so the one that will look like the observational data, is still able to recover the correct value of the equipartition parameter. So what it turns out is that, yes, we have a way, very good, to describe how close to equipartition we are. And this way is this parameter mass of equipartition. A higher mass of equipartition parameter means that the cluster is far away from full equipartition. So we got the first goal nailed. Now we want to use in our simulation again, trying to relate these properties of equipartition to other properties of globular clusters. So equipartition parameter is there on the y-axis. Lower means we're closer to full equipartition. We want to put on the y-axis whatever property that you want of your globular cluster that you're interested in studying. What we put here first is this quantity, which is the number of relaxation time a cluster has experienced, that is the age of the cluster divided by the relaxation time. What you have to understand from this is that the higher this number, the more the star have interact with each other, so the closer to full relaxation, the more relaxed the cluster is. Higher n means the cluster is very relaxed. Lower n means the cluster is not relaxed. And we have different time snapshots, just to represent some of them, 4, 7, and 11 giga years. And what it comes out is that there is a very smooth and tight relation in between the level of equipartition that we have and the relaxation state of the cluster. The more relaxed the cluster is, the full it is to full equipartition. And it seems that you reach a maximum value of equipartition, of partial equipartition, after which you cannot get closer to that value.
Because you're losing low mass stars?
Yeah, so those simulations are quasi-isolated. So actually, they are well-behaved globular cluster at 10 kiloparsec from the center of the Milky Way, so they do feel a tidal field. So they do lose mass. What's happening is that, yeah, you basically, after you have redistributed the energy at the beginning, the masses start sort of go in the center, and they're not able anymore to communicate with the low mass stars, and so the energy exchange kind of slows down and asymptotically stops. So this is a cool way to measure the dynamical state of a cluster, because we know the age of the globular cluster in the Milky Way is always 12, 13 gigayears. We have ways from photometry to measure the relaxation time. It's basically based on how dense the globular cluster is. But now we also have the y-axis. We're starting to have that thanks to the proper motions, because we're able to measure how the kinematic changes changes with the mass. So it's a way in which, if you measure the equipartition parameter from the data, you can tell me directly how relaxed, what is the relaxation state of a cluster. And vice versa, if you only know the relaxation state of a cluster, you can basically predict the mass dependence of the kinematics. And this part, which is actually the easiest, because it does not go through kinematic measurements of the proper motions, has already proven to be pretty cool in, for example, having some prediction of how should binary star behave, what would be their velocity of dispersion, or stars like blue straggler stars. In fact, we've been using that to having a first dynamical estimate of the mass of blue stragglers in globular clusters. So why are we excited? Well, we have this relation. We can start putting in some data point. This is the cluster M15 that I showed you the data before. It was really a rough estimate. The work is still in progress. It is falling where we're wishing it would. But then, once we keep filling all the plots with the data, every deviation from this prediction could potentially tell us a lot about more complex dynamical evolution of the cluster. If this is the relation that a normal cluster, a well-behaved cluster, has experienced, then what happens if there was an intermediate mass black hole in the center? What happened if the cluster originally formed in the nucleus of a dwarf where their environment was very different? Or again, what happened if the cluster was formed in situ in the Milky Way, or instead went through an accretion process? So this is basically where we would like to continue to apply our simulation. And let me skip this and go directly to the next point, which goes again in the line of studying an X-ring ingredient. In this case is the velocity and isotropy, but with the same idea of, we want to understand the origin of the cluster. We want to understand if we can somehow pin down their complex evolution. And so far I show you the globular cluster rotate. Globular cluster have stars with different masses, and each star and different mass pieces show different kinematics feature. But also what I show you right now is that globular clusters are anisotropic. They're mildly anisotropic. And this is a measurement from the data that I showed you before for the globular cluster 47 TAC with the modeling that we've done before. And indeed, radial anisotropy is down here. Tangential anisotropy is up there. Globular cluster seems to tend to be very isotropic in the center, and to go towards radial anisotropic in the intermediate region. And this is now becoming measurable with data. But what I'm interested in, is anisotropy one telling us something about how the cluster has evolved? Because anisotropy is shaped by, first, the internal dynamics of the cluster. While, for example, the cluster expands, stars are preferentially moving on radial orbits, so you will have, during the expansion dominated phase, a radial anisotropic distribution. But then globular clusters also interact with the Milky Way or with their host galaxies, and so the way in which the anisotropy is in the outer part is strongly shaped by the particular tidal interaction that the globular cluster had. And so that's where I want to head to, because if the anisotropy is tracing basically the external tidal field of the galaxy, then it can tell us something about whether the globular cluster has experienced a nice life while it was born in situ in the Milky Way, or a more complex life while it has been accreted and thrown into the Milky Way. And just to remind you a bit, there's at least 2/3 of the globular clusters in the Milky Way that are suspected of being accreted just because of their age-metallicity relation. There's two globular clusters, the most massive one, Omega 7 and M54. They are suspected to be nuclei because they're most massive. They show some complexity in the chemistry. But if we looked at other structural signature, for example, the plot that I show right here from Mihalic, she worked back at McMaster a few years ago, showing what's the evolution of the radius of a globular cluster that has evolved in the Milky Way only, the blue line, that has evolved in a dwarf galaxy only, which is the red line, and that instead has had a mixed evolution. First in a dwarf, the dwarf gets accreted into the Milky Way, and the globular cluster gets released into the Milky Way, and that's the black line. And as you see, the black line, which is the globular cluster that is accreted, eventually tends to have the same structural parameters, so the half-mass radius, of a globular cluster that has evolved only in the Milky Way. So structural properties like the typical size of a globular cluster is not a good tracer of whether a globular cluster has formed in situ or a globular cluster has been accreted. And actually, I've done some simulation myself a couple of years ago. Here at CETA, there was a summer school, ISIMA, and I took part of it. And that's like where my interest in accreted versus in situ globular cluster started. And now I'm pushing it further. We basically are pretty sure that there's no signature of accretion on the size of the cluster. But what if we look at the kinematics? What if we look at into the anisotropy in particular? So there's a new set of simulations. They're run with mbody code, direct mbody code, mbody6tt. The TT stands for tidal tensor, just an extension of the mbody6 code that allows you to basically put into the code any tidal field that you want, time-dependent tidal field. And that's what you want if you want to trace a globular cluster that is experiencing an accretion, because the accretion basically can be described with a time-dependent tidal field. And we have three ingredients. The globular cluster that is made of, for our case, simple case, 50,000 particles with a mass function, stellar evolutions, and different radii to just change the density. We have a Milky Way, bulge disk plus halo, see here in pink, and the dwarf galaxies with that for a start. Has been modeled as a point mass. And two scenarios. They're very simplified, very different, but encompass all the cases that you could possibly think. The first goes under the name of the dwarf fold scenario. The globular cluster is in the dwarf, orbiting the dwarf, while the dwarf galaxy, so feeling the tidal field of the dwarf, then the dwarf galaxy goes and accretes into the Milky Way, but the dwarf still stays there. So what happens is that the globular cluster, while orbiting the dwarf, feels a stronger and stronger Milky Way tidal field. The second scenario is that the dwarf evaporates scenario, and what you have is a globular cluster in the dwarf. The system is in orbit in the Milky Way, and while it orbits, the dwarf loses masses. So basically, that to simulate the disruption of the dwarf galaxies, and at the end, the globular cluster is released in the Milky Way tidal field only. So what we want to see is that if those stellar is these simulations of a simplified accretive globular cluster have some signature in the anisotropy. So we go and plot our anisotropy using our anisotropy parameter beta. Radial anisotropy are up here. Tangential anisotropy are down there. We are looking at the snapshot of 2 giga-years. That is right before the accretion process happens. And we have the accreted globular cluster and the corresponding globular cluster that was evolved only in the Milky Way. And as you see, before the accretion, nothing really weird has happened. The globular cluster is radial, just because it's going through the expansion-dominated phase, so you get some radial orbits going. But if you go in the following snapshot, we are here at 6 giga-years, right when the accretion is over. If you go back and then again, you see that the anisotropy just tends to become lower, so the system tends to isotropize more. This is because the tidal field is having a stronger effect. And if you just wait for 10 giga-years, then you get some systems that are more isotropic. But this is not the only thing that can happen. What we find is that, looking at all our simulations, is that you can have a bunch of different things happening. You can have globular clusters that end up that being accreted and end up to be radial anisotropic, but also globular clusters are very tangential anisotropic. And correspondingly, the Milky Way globular cluster can also be very radial, very isotropic, or very tangential. So just looking from this picture, there's not really a way to discriminate whether a globular cluster or not is being accreted or being or not. I would have wished to just see that all the accreted clusters were just down here and say, okay, if you are more tangential, then you mean you've been accreted. But unfortunately, the universe is not that good, so you have to be a little bit more witty. So what's happening here is that in the inner region, so the anisotropy at the half-mass radius, and now we plot it against the distance of the globular cluster. So these are the globular clusters that have been accreted, the black one, and they end up at the distance of 10 kiloparsec. These are a globular cluster that's been accreted and ends up at the distance of 30 kiloparsec. And the pink dots are instead the Milky Way only. As you can see, in the inner region of the globular clusters, there's no difference between clusters that have been accreted and clusters that have not, that just lived in the Milky Way. Why are we using the distance? Well, we have to talk to observers eventually. And I would like to use this quantity. This is the tidal strength that comes directly. You can compute it directly from the simulation. That is basically telling you how strong was the cumulative tidal field that a globular cluster has experienced. But comes out that this strongly relates to where the globular cluster ended up to be. So stronger tidal field up here gives you globular clusters that are more tangential and isotropic. If we go, though, in the outer part, where that's where we expect the tidal field has a larger effect, you do see that the Milky Way globular clusters just have a very nice trend here. While something is happening with the globular cluster, given a distance to the Milky Way, they have been accreted. So the globular cluster that have been accreted in the Milky Way seems to be systematically more radial anisotropic only in the outer part. So this seems to be a signature of the fact that a globular cluster has been accreted, has experienced a tidal field that's been stronger, and the major effect is in the outer part indeed. And if you look at the profile, this is the profile that we expect for a Milky Way only globular cluster, and is instead a profile of a globular cluster that's been through an accretion process with a very different value of anisotropy in the outer part. Now, that seems very cool, and that's where some work is still in progress. So what can we do? Can we observe this? The answer is we have the HST proper motions to get the velocities, and so their anisotropy in the inner region. So HST proper motion basically sampled this area here, which already gave us some hint on the profile, but it's not going to be able to discriminate the profile right here. But then we have Gaia coming up soon. And Gaia will actually work the best in the outer part, because Gaia is not doing well in the inner part, where you have a crowded field. It's going to do the best in the outer part. And in the outer part is also where you have like the larger amount of contamination. But then if you have the parallax and if you have also the line of sight velocity, it should be relatively easy or like not impossible to detect member stars, get a velocity measurement, and eventually get a measurement of the anisotropy. And possibly using this plot of this type to get an idea of a globular cluster being accreted, just from a kinematics point of view. So to wrap it up, what I show you today is that my mom's favorite cookie is more complex than we all thought. Globular cluster rotate, and the fact that they rotate is somehow giving us the link to what we know from nuclear star clusters. Nuclear star clusters are like the big brothers of globular clusters. And this is fundamental for the initial conditions. So a lot of work still has to be done in understanding how does rotation will evolve. And of course, some work has been done already, but it's very important to understand how to set up the initial condition. Then energy repartition is telling us basically what I showed you is that we can now measure from the data how close to full energy repartition we are. And this is an indicator of the dynamical state of a cluster. And possibly we can use this as a way to discriminate a cluster that underwent a complex dynamical evolution and therefore will experience a different level of energy repartition. And at the end, what I tried to show you was that indeed, looking at the kinematics and, for example, to the velocity anisotropy, you can start looking and figuring out some signature of accretion process, so some direct signature, some fossil record of the formation of the globular clusters. And in particular, velocity anisotropy would indeed could indeed be used as a way to discriminate globular clusters that are formed in situ in an independent or globular cluster that form as accreted in an independent way from the other chemical hints that we have. And we've been doing this, again, using the kinematics. And without proper motion, this would not be possible. And this is only going to get better and better with the new data coming up. And again, the synergy in between the observations and the modeling, trying always to do the modeling in such a way that is directly applicable to the observations. And yeah, good things should just only come next with more line of sight velocity, HST proper motion. And really looking forward to see where Gaia will bring us. Thank you.
Yeah. Is there a way to understand why it should be an exponential?
That's a very good question. So me and Clem van der Ven back in Heidelberg, we've been thinking about it, and we have no answer yet. But so why is it exponential and why is it not a power law, right? So we did try a power law, for example, like a broken power law. And we did see that it does not work as easily well and with like this. So this almost magic thing about this function is that you only have a parameter here and then you get all the snapshot of every simulation. I do not know what that could be. It's clearly connected to what is probably the initial mass function of the cluster, because it's telling you how much massive star you have with respect to the low mass stars that you have. And this could probably change the shape of the function, but it's definitely something that is still in the back of my mind, and I find it particularly appealing of why an exponential.
Just a short question. So you've heard 47 packets rotating very fast. Do you expect every other global cluster to be similar? Would you somehow couldn't looking at it at the wrong axis?
Yeah, so I would expect that at least the most massive ones, they will all rotate. So as far as I know, every global cluster has been looked at on along the line of sight with some, just taking some velocity, some rotation was always found. Maybe it was like 1 kilometer per second, so very subtle, but still has been found. And there's a clear connection between the flattening of the global cluster and the rotation. So probably, the one that appears most flattened, they rotate the most on the line of sight. That's what it was thought about 47 TAC. But I wouldn't be surprised if globular clusters that even appear spherical would turn up to rotate on the plane of the sky. So the well, I guess you're mostly likely, yeah, to see something in between. So,
yeah, 60 degrees.
Yes. Yeah. So the key there is like not. Unfortunately, with HST proper motion, we can only do it if we have special case of background stars. With Gaia, you will have some information though.
Would Gaia be enough to lock your HST observation?
I think so. Yeah, that would be actually, I think people are working on that and already doing that with the first release of Gaia to get the global proper motion of the cluster, which will get better and better if you have HST and Gaia together. And then when you have the proper motion of Gaia, then you can also probably do that, yeah.
So two quick questions. The first one, they showed that there's a random inclinations that kind of work to fit your data. How much does that influence your velocity measurement? What's the uncertainty in terms of the velocity measurement?
The uncertainty, sorry, Andy?
On the velocity support.
Oh, that would change it a lot. So if you had a 45 degree angle, so like our first assumption, the intrinsic velocity support would be close to a factor of to 1.5 lower than what we happen to see now.
So what's the uncertainty in your algorithm?
I fear we haven't gone through the uncertainty yet with the analysis. Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
So can that be understood via some kind of analytic thing in the steady state
or stationary? So there's a nice easy work by Spitzer, 1967, with a two mass sort of component, and they do show that equipartition is not possible, and there's a limit. It's called basically the Spitzer instability. If you have too many massive objects, those massive objects, with respect to the low mass object, they will just fall in the center and form an independent subsystem that will stop communicating with the thing outside.
We're reaching.
Well, we sort of reached a state that we cannot go further to that, right? So what's happening is that the way in which the stars are now distributed is kind of locked.
So is a lot of
the
clustering in this kind of model, does it just continue to lose mass.
And of course, that would depend on which kind of tidal field you have, because that will influence how you lose the mass. But if you have, yeah.
This probably also depends on IMF.
That will depend on the IMF as well, yes. Yeah.
And how much did it be? Because I saw you had done it for both 10 and 50% binarity. Did that make a big difference?
Oh, no, it does not change at all. So you cannot distinguish the initial binarity. That does not make a difference. It changes the relaxation time.
Right.
So it just basically shift the things a little bit this way. But it's not a big difference.
Nice. It's
yeah.
So you said that most people ignore the rotation. Presumably, at first approximation, the rotation is 0.2 of the dispersion velocity. That's okay. At 0.9 is probably an important effect. Even earlier, it must have been higher. So did that change the picture of the dynamic?
I think that would change a lot the picture of like the early formation stage. And for example, how massive was a globular cluster when it formed? I do think that if you assume that the globular cluster does not rotate, that the mass loss and the dynamical timescale is way different than a globular cluster that is rotating. And indeed, some of the early work about how a rotating globular cluster will evolve with time showed that rotation accelerates the dynamical evolution of a cluster. So, yeah, so that it's a good line of research. And just to make it worse, like, at the origin, when the globular clusters were formed, they must have been rotating, there were stars, there were gas, and that's where you have the problem of the multiple stellar population. In that precise moment where you have all this dynamical mass, you also have to form two different kind of stars. They have the same metallicity, but different element component abundances. And that's still a very big open issue. So the more we understand, the more we get closer to the 13 giga years ago, the better. The more we understand it, the better it is. But we're still far, I think, to having an answer to these open questions.
Can you remind me, is the black curve on this plot just an empirical fitting function?
Yeah. Just an empirical fitting function.
Okay. You could think of just taking the three points to the rightmost of that curve and just erasing them. Then you could think, then the evidence for this plateau isn't so apparent.
Yeah.
So you can imagine if you collect a lot more data, maybe the points would be lower. Do you think that would happen?
So the simulations were like a set of simulations that was done in 2011 or so. Now with the simulation of the accreted globular cluster that I talk about the anisotropy, I actually did play the game of calculating the equipartition parameter. I have not put it in the plot yet, but I have the data. And what comes out is that the cluster that are the most relaxed get this 1.55. So it seems to be very general and does not depend on an accretion or in situ origin. So this is something that seems to come out of it. But it means that it's also not dependent on the tidal field, and so it's a strictly internal dynamical property of the cluster. So this makes it stronger.
Okay.
So maybe we can be talking upstairs with the people. Thank you.
Thank you.